Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Steve Bassam, also known as Lord Bassam of Brighton, former Brighton and Hove Council leader, former government minister, Labour peer, not former. Welcome to the programme. Thanks ever so much for joining us. You like cricket. Let's pitch you an easy one for starters. How would you describe the difference between the council chamber, all those years you spent in it down here, and the chamber of the House of Lords, where you spend so many years since?
The difference, I guess, the House of Lords, there's more interrogation, more wanting to seek an answer, perhaps a sort of more mature consideration of some of the sort of issues of the day. You've got some extraordinarily bright and clever people there. A lot of them are only there because actually they really want to be, and, you know, crossbenchers in particular sort of pitched to get there. And then you've got people who are the party faithful. But, nevertheless, they have a questioning approach, even to their own government ministers, even to their own front bench.
And, I mean, since Jeremy Corbyn was elected Labour leader, some of the old tensions or divisions between the left and the right of the party have raised their head again. I mean, you dealt with some of these when you were council leader down here. Seeing that sort of those kind of tensions arise again, how much does that worry you?
It's always a feature of politics. Parties, if they didn't have internal dynamic or questioning, they would be a rather dull place. So
I appreciate these are not necessarily... I'm asking about Labour tensions. You're a Labour peer, but I appreciate yours is not the only party that has these kind of tensions.
Mm. I've been particularly entertained in the last year, I guess, watching ministers struggle with Brexit and facing harder questions sometimes from behind them than they do in front. Chris Patten demolished the case for Brexit for me in one of his best speeches ever during the course of the EU withdrawal bill. And he's been a constant thorn in the government's side on that issue, as have a lot of people who would have been very recognisable in frontline politics 20 years ago.
I just wonder whether you sort of... They perhaps speak less often, but with more force when they really put their minds to it these days.
I think they speak with greater freedom because... they feel slightly liberated from the sort of shackles of the Commons whipping system.
And is that also because they don't actually have to worry about seeking re-election?
Well, I think that plays part of it. But you'd be surprised just how tribal people are. And I think people feel genuinely upset sometimes when they feel they have to go against their own party line. It can be quite a sort of upsetting thing because it's part of your nature, yourself, your political culture, your background and so on.
And, I mean, with the kind of tensions that we've seen, I mean, locally, Labour's selecting candidates for the local elections next May 2019. Yeah. And, there appears to me to be quite an organised campaign to put up as many candidates as possible who support Momentum, which is the organisation set up to, if you like, buoy up, support Jeremy Corbyn and his colleagues when they took the leadership of the Labour Party. And, again, I guess I wanted to sort of... try to understand how much that worries somebody like you who's probably been through all this before, and here we go again.
Well, look, in the 80s, there were a group of us who came into the party from the left, and we thought we had all the answers. Eventually, several of us ended up in leading positions in the council. I became council leader in 1986-7, and, there were tensions then. There was always a left and a right. There was certainly organisation behind selection meetings. I thought in the 80s there was a sort of renewal of Labour locally. I think it's going through a similar process now. It's probably more organised and orchestrated. And I think there needs to be respect within the local party for people, different wings of the party, different philosophical points of view, because everyone's got a contribution to make. I've been reading through the CVs of candidates pitching to become councillors where I live, and, you know, they're very plausible. They're touch on the same sort of issues that affected Brighton 30-odd years ago.
I mean, in some respects, it must seem what's changed. You put all that effort in and actually some of the same old problems rear their heads again, sometimes in a different way.
Well, I think some of the problems facing Brighton, and, you know, in terms of inequality and poverty and so on, are perennial, and some of them there have been some progress made on. But last few years, I feel that locally in some areas we've been going backwards because of the... as a result, largely, of the sort of austerity measures from the government.
And, I mean, to, obviously, when they're one of the difficult things. I mean, Tony Blair, when he became the Labour leader, for example, one of the things he really tried to do was present his party as a united force to the electorate, a united front, on the basis that voters don't like voting for divided parties. I mean, both the main parties at the moment have.
Well, there's an irony,
divisions.
Isn't there? I mean, clearly the government is bitterly divided, but it's at the moment, if you look, follow the opinion polls, it's the second most popular party in the country, and it's still got a big percentage of support. There are divisions within the Labour Party. There's no denying that. You know, I tend to see that as important features of debate. Some aspects of those divisions within both parties are perhaps not what you want to see politically, but they're important.
I mean, the Tories are going to go locally. The Tories seem to have had a pact not to discuss Brexit, really. So the big dividing sort of schism in the party nationally is not really playing out sort of vocally around here, whereas they're going to really go for the divisions in Labour on, the sort of, if you like, the Corbynites v the rest, or momentum and its effect.
I think they would be mistaken to do that. I've read the local mini-manifestos that people are coming up with, and they focus on local issues, really. The importance of housing is obviously one of the big ones. We need a lot more houses in and around the city, building programmes there. Current Labour administration has made an important start. Needs to be much more of that if we're to provide lower-cost housing for generations in the future. They would be better off playing, getting into that debate.
Being constructive about what they would do rather than...
Yeah, exactly.
But I mean, one of the challenges you've got, if the pitch to voters from Labour next May is, look, we've done a good job for the past 4 years, now give us a majority so we can do an even better job, and yet more than half the current councillors have already sort of said they're not standing, and of the remaining half, there are concerns not all will be selected.
I think, going back to your initial question about momentum and their impact and so on, I think members of the party would do well to recognise that you need to have a core of experience in a Labour group. That's not to say that sometimes you get an injection of new blood. It doesn't do the local political system any harm because people come into things with a fresh set of eyes, and that's important.
And presumably, I guess the other thing is the longer you've been a councillor, the more you sort of become... I mean, what in Yesminster they used to call politicians becoming house-trained by their permanent secretaries and so on, but...
Well, there is a risk of that. I've seen that in government.
You go native, if you like. You sort of become part of the system rather than one of the people challenging it, which is part of your role as a councillor.
It can get too cosy, but on the other hand, you need a blend of experience, youth, people who are prepared to pound the streets, people who are prepared to say things that need to be said, even if sometimes they're not always the most popular.
And I mean, well, yes, indeed. It's quite. I mean, again, that political skill set, both the sort of needing the diplomatic skills to be able to make your case with some elegance, etc., but also to be able to know when to sort of, if you like, metaphorically thump the table.
Yeah, I think the most important thing for people locally is to hear from their local councillors, to know who they are, to be able to see that the ruling group has got a clear sense of direction and vision for the city. I think that probably. That, for me, would be one of the most important things. Brighton needs constant renewal.
I mean, like the weeds in the garden. You can't just say, we've mowed the weeds, that's it, it's done. You have to keep going back and doing it again and again, and a bit like that with politics, presumably.
Yeah, I'm currently conducting a select committee inquiry into regenerating seaside towns, and what seems to me to be quite clear from the early stages of the inquiry is that you need to have a constant sort of process of regeneration. If you don't, you get left behind. And you've got to find ways in which you can make your town, your city, whether it's Brighton and Hove or Hastings or wherever, interesting and attractive.
I'm smiling because I just remember back in the 80s when you became leader, one of the things that obviously sort of, I think, gave you some momentum with a small M and a completely different sense of political momentum was actually looking at RC Frontier, which was quite tawdry and run down, and beginning a process that still isn't finished.
No, I mean,
we're now seeing with the Madeira terraces, God, there's even more to do,
Well, I mean, there's a big project there. They're sort of protected and listed. They need a large injection of capital, and I don't think there's any denying that where it comes from and when it comes is the issue.
I mean, I mean, obviously that's the sort of, if you like, the physical infrastructure of it, but presumably what you're talking about as well is what we saw with your initial policy here was looking, going down West Street, turning right, all that bit between the Palace Pier and the West Pier,
yeah,
trying to sort of not just do the physical stuff, but get businesses there, footfall,
yeah.
feeling
safe.
It
didn't feel like a health and safety, healthy and safety safe place to be when we first looked at it. But we came up with a seafront development initiative, which has been incredibly successful, and people flock to that part of Brighton, as they do the rest of the beach, but there in particular, because there's so much going on and it's full of different attractions.
And I mean, again, very briefly before we take a quick break for the ads, I mean, does it surprise you, though, how long it took from having those ideas, if you like, and chucking them about with your colleagues in the party, to seeing the changes that we now see?
I suppose, in a sense, we as an administration benefited from a long period of continued control of the authority. So from 1986, Labour ran Brighton right through, really, until the 2000s. And then, you know, in the sort of mid-90s, we combined with Hove to create a bigger authority, and we were able to carry the programme on.
Well, listen, we'll just take a quick break there. Please don't go away. Join us again after these ads. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LaDuke, and my guest today, Steve Bassam, Lord Bassam of Brighton. Thanks, Steve, for joining us. Just before we sort of move on to one or two other topics, there's one aspect that we were talking about before the break about some of the challenges at the moment between different bits of the party. There's been discord over claims of anti-Semitism. I've, as an outsider looking in, I wonder, to what extent is that problem real? And how much of it is, if you like, a proxy battle between the supporters of Jeremy Corbyn and those who see him as problematic?
Well, my guess is it's probably a mix of the two. I think there is an issue. The sort of Labour has historically had a long connection with Jewish communities in this country. There's a fantastic track record of not just of representation, but actually in the founding years of the party. Many famous sort of Jewish MPs and ministers and so on. I think there is an issue around the way in which it's been dealt with. I think that senior members of the party are beginning to realise that that needs not just addressing but dealing with. I think they've been slow to recognise the scale of the problem, it's not easy to deal with. But it's there and it must be dealt with. Anti-Semitism isn't just a subset of racism, and we've got to move away from some of that sort of perception. And that's not just within the Labour Party, but generally within society.
It's an easy one to ask and a hard one to deal with, I do appreciate.
Yeah.
I almost want to say, by the way, do you have a prediction for next May here?
Well, the local elections?
Yes.
I think Labour's going to do extremely well. I'd be very surprised if our party didn't have an outright majority. Brighton's changing demographically. Those changes have been going on for the last 20 years. The Tories are a sort of fringe suburban party in Brighton. They don't really have much appeal or resonance in the city centre.
They still pick up about a third of the vote, but
30-35%.
They do. The Greens showed in 2011, you can leverage that if you...
You can, but their votes are very concentrated in particular parts of the city. The general election results were stunning for Brighton's Labour Party and Hove's Labour Party. I suppose the only question really is, can the Greens recover any territory? And I think that's unlikely, really.
And I know they're not here to argue their corner. I'm sure they say differently. One thing that came up at the weekend, by the way, that was interesting was the Tolpuddle Martyrs March and an announcement from your leader.
Oh, yes. Long-term obsession of mine, actually. Not really a great many people in Brighton and Hay would be terribly interested in it, but...
Or indeed in the leader's constituency, I'm going to venture.
I shouldn't think there are too many agricultural workers in Islington, but no, I thought it was interesting that he said that return of a Labour government would see the return of the institution that was agricultural wages boards. And those wages boards were set up under Labour in the post-war Attlee government, and they protected generations of agricultural workers, one of whom was my mother, and... It kept us out of poverty and it prevented poverty wages in there.
I mean, I know you were saying that probably might not matter so much to people in Brighton and Hove and perhaps even to
Well, it matters if they think about it in the terms of the living wage. And there is its significance. Obviously, a very early measure in a radical Labour government, which served our country very well. And I thought the Tories, back in the period after the 2010 election were foolish to get rid of it because it sent not just a bad sign to people, but it said you didn't value agricultural workers.
Well, I mean, part of the reason I was sort of only slightly tongue-in-cheek going, it might not matter to people in Brighton Hove, we've got a lot of horticulture, of course, just outside Brighton Hove in West Sussex. We've relied on a lot of people coming from the European Union, the poorer Eastern European countries, for example, or Southern European countries, to pick our fruit. And with Brexit and the population changes that may precipitate, presumably, if we want the fruit not to just rot on the trees.
Well, it's going to be a big issue. I recently watched a programme and read some material suggesting that, you know, there are very few British workers who go out picking soft fruits. I think that could decimate our strawberry and raspberry growing sectors.
I wonder whether a creative government or a creative administration or creative local councils, East Sussex, West Sussex, Brighton and Hove, might not institute some kind of scheme where, you know, I think it's a young person's game picking fruit. I clutch my back at the thought of it. And I picked it when I was younger. I want to go out and pick strawberries now.
Have you seen how they do it? They lie flat on a trolley which gradually moves across the field, and they work really hard. If you do it standing up or crouching down, it's back rake.
No. Well, I used to pick strawberries bending, but we also used to have the people from London taking holidays out in the Kent countryside picking hops, for example. I just wonder whether we might need to sort of go back to the future a little if we're going to make, you know, Britain work post Brexit. Perhaps Jeremy's a bit more. Jeremy Corbyn might be perhaps something that, you know, I felt like I started this by feeling like I was taking the mickey a little bit, the more I think about it.
It's a serious issue.
I don't know, absolutely. And I guess the trouble is when you're as facetious and glib as I am, and then suddenly you start digging below the depth a little. I did want to ask you about something that we all need gallows humour to cope with at the moment, I think, and that's the commute to London. You go up on the train.
I do. I recently suffered a 4.5-hour, 4.75-hour journey where I changed 3 times just to get from London to Brighton. And I then asked a whole host of questions of the government ministers, and all they could tell me really was that 68% of trains on that day across the southern region had arrived within 5 minutes of their allotted slot.
Really reassuring.
Millions of people that day were disrupted, going to work and coming back from work. I asked them how much they thought they'd pay in compensation, how many people they thought were affected by this, what their impact was on local communities, and they wouldn't give me an answer on any of these things. I found that pretty appalling, actually.
Would they not give you an answer, or do they not know the answer, or is there a sense of, because we've given the railway...
Well, the question is this, look, if you can tell me that 68% of everybody who got a train that day arrived within 5 minutes of the arrival time, surely you can have some reasonable and decent estimate of what the cost is to the taxpayer.
Yes. Yeah, no, fair enough. And I mean, what's the real issue here? We've got a programme of modernising the infrastructure. Are we seeing every bit of modernisation then have a knock-on effect and knock out, if you like, the weakest link in the chain further down the line, as it were?
Well, there are two issues for me. I think one is the division in ownership between track and train. Now, I favour renationalising. Renationalising of itself won't just solve the problem. You've got to have a management, the culture of which is designed to move people from where they are to where they need to be in a timely fashion, a culture that actually tries to succeed.
If it's a track and train divide, why not just say, I don't know, let GTR, the current franchisee, if they can get things working again.
I wouldn't give them another contract on their track record.
Run the track as well. Their credibility is an issue at the moment, really, is as a company.
Certainly is, with any passenger I ever talked to.
Yeah. I guess the other thing is that, you know, again, you're old enough, I'm old enough to remember British Rail, and which did own the track and train, and did have the sort of, if you like, the holistic wider network ownership as well. And that was far from perfect. We didn't get the infrastructure investment that we're now seeing, because it was subject to public sector cuts during the
What you don't want is stop and start investment, and that was occasionally a feature of having a nationalised rail system. But, you know, we've got stop and start investment now, and it's privately owned, and I don't see the benefit of having that train divide. What I want to see is a management and a management culture that overcomes the issues that are there and provides answers to people. They couldn't even provide me basic information at Victoria Station. The best piece of advice I had was to go get a beer mate, you know. And I said, well, join me at Wetherspoons. And the info guy was roaring with laughter at that point.
He'd probably quite like to have the info thing set up there, actually. So
I had to resort at one point during this ridiculous episode to creeping up behind a clutch of drivers who were parked on a platform chatting to each other, simply because they'd got their little iPads out and were being sent emails from somewhere that was telling them that, A, they weren't going to Barnum or Bognor or Worthing or wherever.
I have resorted to this tactic.
You know, it's ludicrous, absolutely bonkers. We've got we're information saturated in this country.
Yes.
We've got display boards everywhere. And yet I couldn't find out whether I was going to get home before midnight. As it was, I didn't.
I have someone who goes up to London relatively frequently. I share your pain. Mm. There is pressure going for layout changes at Wimble Junction, which is a bottleneck by East Croydon, you know, very close to East Croydon Station. Mm. I mean, there are two. That may solve some of our problems with capacity.
May do.
And there's pressure for something called the Brighton Main Line 2, a sort of an alternative route via Lewis.
No, well, it's an issue I've been banging on about for about 30 years. They need to reconnect Uckfield and Lewis, and they need to provide...
Is it going to happen? I mean, is this a pipe dream for us?
Well, it may be a pipe dream for some rail executives, but I think it's a realistic proposition. It could easily be done. It's 7 miles of track. It could grow into a much bigger project. An old railman in the 70s said to me, the problem with the southern region area is there are insufficient loops in it.
Yes.
And although Beeching had some regard to the sort of strategic nature of what he was up to, what he didn't understand was the need to put ways around a problem. It's just like having a road network.
Yes.
You
need diversions.
You need diversions. And the current network in the south is the busiest in the world, and it hasn't got any of those.
Well, it's been an interesting diversion chatting to you about those things, and good luck. Thanks ever so much for joining us.
Pleasure.
Please join us again on The Vote before too long. Thanks
Always
for watching.
Always happy to do that.
Goodbye for now.
Thank you.